All right, 1, 2, 3, here we go. We are all arrogant. The mind that believes it's a body at all is completely arrogant. The mind that believes it's a baby's body is arrogant. The mind that believes it's a woman's body is arrogant. The mind that believes it's a man's body is arrogant. All sheer arrogance. All sheer arrogance. And this is the call to truth, is for each one of us to recognize that we have been employing arrogance. Arrogance basically says that reality is arrogant to be unchangeable. The unchangeableness of reality means that reality is arrogant. This is what we have claimed as the Son of God, which is really the prime created. Instead of the prime creator, the prime created, the extension of God, wanted to be greater than God, saying, hey, wait a minute. Reality can be changed. I can be greater than God. But reality cannot be changed. But we've insisted, oh, reality is so arrogant, it cannot be changed. How arrogant. We have to cure reality of its arrogance. And so we think we're curing reality of its arrogance. It's not true. We're the ones who are being arrogant in claiming that we can change reality. So it's all of us. Each one has to look into the mirror and recognize they're the ones who are stuck in arrogance and stuck with the continuity fear about letting go of arrogance. And stop projecting their own arrogance onto others and claiming by doing so, therefore, they are not arrogant. This is the disease, the massive plague, spiritual plague of these times is called projection. Now, it is very interesting that A Course in Miracles, which was information given to this world by Jesus Christ, tends to focus very strongly on projection and helps us really recognize what's going on with projection. And it came out right at the time when projection began to be used as the central ploy in this world of those who are trying to, as you might say, control everyone in the world. Those who are trying to turn this world into a new world order, a dictatorship, basically a corporation, and working in conjunction with a larger corporation in the cosmos. I call it cosmic corporate culture. They use projection as a weapon. This is their central weapon that they have been using in this world. So Jesus gives us this information about projection and enables us, those who study it, to become very wise about projection and taking the burden on themselves, realizing, hey, I need to set my arrogance down and not project it, but to set it down, exchange it for truth. And this has provided a protection to us. So if you're wondering, how am I able to speak out like this? Because of Course in Miracles, that's why. Because of Jesus Christ, that's why, who gave us the tools and showed us, you know, this, that you're under this terrible spell of projection, arrogance, and then projection. Projection is one of the chief defenses of arrogance, okay? And what I've noticed in the world is that there are those, like a tribe, you might call it, a tribe of projectionists, those who use projection constantly, almost, you know, just, they're very, very, very adept at using projection to blame others and get the responsibility off of themselves for dealing with their own arrogance. And it's just so blatant. It is so blatant and so obvious. But the thing with about projection, once you become hooked into using it very strongly, is that you just can double down on it continuously. If someone points out, whatever anyone points out, you project it back onto them. You know, whatever your faults are, they point out your faults, you just project it onto the one who's bringing it to your attention. And you feel, oh, I it's gone. I don't have it. They're the ones who have it. And so they seem incurable. They seem unstoppable. Because, you know, most of us have some conscience where we say, no, wait a minute. If I just keep doubling down on this projection, which is a lie, this is going to get me in a lot of trouble. And we say, no, I don't want to do that. But there are some in this world who seem to be have reckless disregard for that, and simply just continue to double down on projection. Now, this seems to give them a tremendous amount of power in this world. They have this confidence. It's the confidence of projection. They feel they're really like very severe bullies. They can bully everyone around, and because they're never wrong, and they're those who object to whatever they're doing are always wrong. All the blame rests on them. All the arrogance rests on them. None rests on themselves at all. But and they do this without having set arrogance down. Now, of course, if when you set arrogance down, then you're free of arrogance, and that's genuine spiritual confidence, recognizing that reality is not arrogant, that it cannot be changed, and that is not arrogant to set arrogance down. Then they are, quote unquote, always right. They're free of arrogance. But that's a different story, isn't it? That they didn't get free because of projection. So projection is a strategy by arrogance to it seems as though you're winning, okay? And you're going to, by projecting all arrogance onto others, you seem to be free of arrogance. And you think so, you think, well, I'm getting free. I'm free of it. This is working for me. So it's a very seductive tactic, very seductive defense system. And of course, in miracles goes through this and brings this to light over in many, 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 many ways. And so in studying that, I got to understood, I've been able to sort of recognize what's going on here in the world. And it's really shocking when you see that the way that things are going in this world is you realize it's based on projection. People believe that winning projection is the winning strategy. Now, what I say and what truth really tells me to say is that there is no winning strategy other than setting arrogance down. And what arrogance says is that we're in a contest with God. That God, we're trying to say who's arrogant and who's not, and we're trying to prove that God's the one that's arrogant, reality's arrogant, and we're not. So it's like a contest here, and we're trying to win the contest. And arrogance believes by projecting, this is the way to win. This is the way to win. And Jesus tells us, no, it's not the way. It's the way to enmesh yourself in duality. And all the terrible struggles, and the more that you project, of course, the less work you're doing on setting arrogance down, the more arrogant you become. And you don't realize it. You think everybody else is arrogant. Or not everybody else, the those who oppose whatever your agenda is. So you belong to a tribe. And I find that the people in this world are separating out into tribes. And there's a tribe of projectionists, those who use projection. And when they're around each other, they all kind of feel like they're infallibly right. Infallibly right. Instead of feeling like, you know what? I feel like I'm really very much of a sinner. Like I'm trying to compete with God. I'm trying to claim that I'm greater than God. I have the sin of arrogance. I need to really humbly work on this. They don't feel that way. They feel that they're winners. They're a tribe of winners, and they're dominating everyone else. And this is the way it should be because they're infallible, and that all fault rests on the shoulders of others. So arrogance advises us. How to quote unquote win this contest with God. Again, a contest that doesn't exist. We made it up. In order to claim that we can be greater than God, we have to make up this contest, which God is not involved in the slightest bit. Reality is perfect, remains perfect, and that is not arrogant. There's nothing to be arrogant against. God created everything perfect. There isn't any imperfection. So how can you claim that perfection is arrogant? Arrogant to what? Arrogant to what? It's not arrogating any properties to itself that it wasn't created with. So we're just upset that God didn't allow us to change reality. That's all. So we have this very strong tribalism right now. People are dividing among these lines of those who are being trying to be honest with themselves, and those who are thinking that projection is this magical pill, this magical solution, And it can be extraordinarily seductive. And so many in this world are being pulled into this, thinking like they finally found the answer. Gosh, all I have to do is project all my troubles with arrogance onto someone else and blame them and join the tribe of projecting. And there's this whole power structure now with projection, which backs this up. This goes all the way to the very top now. And the problem of the world is, it's very seductive because when you're an expert at projecting and blaming others and taking no responsibility for the work that for your own arrogance, then you can arise in this world. You can rise up to positions of great power and control under certain circumstances, such as we have today, where there's been a vast undermining of spiritual will on this planet. So you can get an entire power structure all the way to the top, all the way down through the ministers, secretaries, the bureaucracy, judicial system, schools, media, corporations. You can get this massive pyramid of arrogant projection in place in the world, with it seems to be, winning, getting all the power, winning, getting things going their way. And other people look at that, those who are kind of weak-willed, they look at that and they say, "Wow, that's, I want to join that side. That's a winning side." And of course they're told, "Well, it's easy. It's easy. All you gotta do is blame others for your troubles. That's it. Don't take any responsibility for your troubles. Blame others. They're the ones who are arrogant. They're the ones that need to be punished. They're the ones who need to be enslaved." They're, and so it's very seductive. You think, "Oh, gee, that's easy. I don't need to do any work on myself. Oh, great. I don't need to work towards setting my arrogance down. Oh, wow, okay." And I mean, I get all this power and help and empowerment and everything. Oh, gee, okay. So this is the situation we have in the world now. It's a massive plague around the planet, a severe plague. Now, those who've actually done the work of looking at their own arrogance and repenting and saying, "Wow, this is wrong. Everything I've been doing, believing I'm a body in a world, stuck in situations and circumstances, that's all total arrogance, absolute total arrogance. To believe that I'm vulnerable, that's arrogance." And working on all this, then they're not so susceptible to this. Since having already done a lot of work, they're not going to try to take the easy way out that doesn't work. They say, "No, I'm going to keep working on this." And so there are those in this world like that. But they seem to be the minority now because, who wants to do the tough work? A lot of people like to take the easy way out. And it's really not any, it's not an out. It's you bring, you're really going into darkness, very severe darkness, those who do this. So arrogance always advises us to somehow look favorably upon arrogance, or that it's not a problem for us. Now, this is very tricky ways that it does this. Now, sometimes it says arrogance is good. It's necessary, it's important, it's good. And when it can get people to buy into that, then you might have a division. You might have it divided up in this world. Usually things are divided up between male and female in this world, male and female, and they'd say, "Well, arrogance is good, and men seem to have this more forceful arrogance. So we're going to say that men are good. This is the way, and arrogance is good. It's good. It's a good thing. Let's just follow this." And then later on, when they see that, this doesn't work, then arrogance has another trick up its sleeve. It says, "Hey, arrogance is bad, but it's the men that are arrogant. The women are not arrogant. You see, so let's put women in charge, and they will be free of arrogance because they're not arrogant." And this too is the advice of arrogance. Both men and women are engaged in sheer arrogance. The mind that believes it's a woman and the mind that believes it's a man is completely arrogant. Completely arrogant. That belief system is totally arrogant. Okay, totally. And there are many, many styles of arrogance. It's easy to think that men are more arrogant than women simply, because of the stereotypes that have male stereotypes. All right. And being what, boastful, I guess, or outspoken. But well, women are much shrewder, much more shrewd and clever, clever and know how to, much more political as far as manipulating situations. And But they're just as arrogant as men, absolutely just as arrogant as men. But we think that somehow we're following advice which is helping us get free of arrogance. You see? And then guilt is used in this whole thing too. So this is what we're saying here, is that the notion that we can keep shuffling this deck and say, well, let's put this group in charge, they're not arrogant, this group. The only group that is reliable to some extent in this world are those who have taken up the challenge of setting their arrogance down and realizing, hey, I have to repent. I have to take up this challenge and realizing I am equal with God because God created me that way, and I can't change that. I cannot change what God created. I am spirit, I'm free. I'm still exactly as God created me. I'm spirit, I'm free, I'm still exactly as God created me, and I'm perfect, and I can't do anything about that. Okay? Those are the only ones that can navigate towards true freedom from suffering, true liberation, freedom from fear. Those are the ones. Now, they're not perfect, you see, because when we start being honest with ourselves and trying to set our arrogance down, well, we still have a lot of arrogance, so far from perfect, and yet they admit to their imperfections. Okay, they admit, I've got a lot of imperfections, I still have a lot of arrogance, humble, repentant, confessing that, that they're still very arrogant. Those are the ones that can be relied upon to be helpful in this world. But those who are not able to confess their own sin of arrogance and be honest about it and not project and say, hey, I have to do the work, and I call everybody else that they have to do the work too. We all have to do the work of repentance. Remember, Jesus washed the feet of the apostles. He was showing them, be humble. Say, look, we all have to wash our feet of arrogance, wash the dust of arrogance off our feet. Not that he was arrogant, but he was showing an example for them. It is, be like a servant unto all in terms of your own humility and the own work. You keep working on yourself. Don't get up into a puffed up with pride because you're working on it. You keep working on it, all right? Be humble, be lowly, like a servant. The last will be first, and the first will be last. So this means that those who keep using projection to puff themselves up as if they're all great in this world, they'll be the last to be saved. And the ones who seem to be lowly because they're saying, I have a lot of problems, and I'm working on them, and they work on the challenge, it's a very severe challenge of setting arrogance down, they will be the first to be liberated from fear. So here we're admitting to our mistakes, huge mistakes. We're seeing them, and this is the best thing. We're super happy to see our extreme mistakes we've been making, instead of claiming that somehow we've never made any mistake, we've never had any defenses, we don't, our minds are perfect. Well, instead of saying our arrogance is perfect, arrogance is right, and defending arrogance, instead of defending arrogance and saying, no, there's a way to win, and we have a projection, we say, no, there's no way to win. There is no winning. There is no winning. There's no way to win. This is the mind. As it's setting arrogance down, is to say, I'm accepting there isn't any way to win. It's great, because nobody needs to win. We're already perfect. There's no way to win. Now, arrogance loves to try to blur the difference between arrogance and repentance and humility. That's part of its game too. It's very tricky in confusing us and trying to say, you know what, there's really not that big of a difference, or it's pretty much the same, or you're projecting too, or you're saying that you're perfect, and so it gets very confusing for those who are not repentant. Those who are still arrogant say, wait a minute, you're no better than I am, and what are you talking about? Now you're claiming you're getting success, and you think you're a winner too, and so arrogance is very clever at confusing the issue here, very clever. But those who have repented and work on it are not fooled by it. Okay, they're not. But the arrogance is confused over it. Very confused. Easily gets confused. Easily gets confused. You know, you don't read a book by its cover. And so you have to get into repentance and find out what it's all about instead of just superficially judging it. You don't know until you really work at it. You don't know. So arrogance can't know the truth. Arrogance is a denial of the truth. Arrogance cannot know the path to salvation. It's a denial of that path. It's on a path towards winning, it thinks. So we have this massive disease, this massive epidemic on the planet. You know, it like as a doctor trying to treat this, you know, you're overwhelmed because everyone seems to have, you know, be extremely resistant. They seem to be extremely sick. The sick, terrible sickness of projection. And those who are trying to work on freeing themselves from arrogance are under massive assault right now. And we feel that if we don't join the tribe of projection, the so-called winning strategy of arrogance, that we're going to end up being enslaved here. Severely enslaved, because the whole structure holding up, you know, that enables us to breathe repentance here, enables us to breathe the air of repentance, which is all important. As you walk about your life in this world, you should be able to breathe the air of repentance. You should be able to feel it. You should be able, there should be society and the way society is structured. You should be able to feel that you're okay in that society. You belong to that society. But right now, that's no longer really the case here. It's no longer the case. I haven't breathed that air from anybody in the longest time. At least as I walk around, you know, people I meet in the street, the society, the civilization, everything we live in. It's like there's no air here. No air of repentance. So those who are very, very willing to engage in severe projection can seem to win great victories over people because they're very intimidating, very bullying, and they bully people through guilt into accepting their agendas because they say, hey, you know, we're right, you're wrong, and they're projecting on others that you're to blame, you're the bad one, and they say, but if you put us in power and let our agendas be support our agenda, we'll no longer see you as being so bad. And therefore, you'll lose the guilt, okay? So once you get projected upon, you feel this guilt, then you think, wow, how do I get free of this guilt? Oh, all I have to do is agree that I'm bad and my repentance is bad and join the those who project, and then I'll be free of guilt. This is how it works. Is you can get a group of very determined people who are all in on projecting on others their own faults and their own trouble and claiming that others are being discriminatory towards them or are bad towards them by, of course, pointing out their faults. Say, hey, wait a minute, you know, you're not so perfect yourself. I mean, you know, in fact, you've got a lot of problems. Why don't you work on those problems instead of, you know, trying to push guilt off on us? You know, why don't you join the tribe of accepting responsibility for your arrogance and working on the challenge that Jesus and others have given us to set our arrogance down. That's what we're here for. Instead of doing that, they go all in on projecting and try to convince you that you're the bad one. You're guilty. You're guilty. You were guilty for saying that we needed to work on stuff. We don't need to work on stuff. That was your problem. We don't have that problem. You're guilty. So how do you get free of that guilt? Support their agenda. Support their projection. Agree with their projections. Saying, oh yeah, you're right. Yeah, you're perfect in your arrogance. And I was wrong, that kind of thing. No one is perfect in their arrogance. Arrogance is a denial of perfection. You cannot be perfect in arrogance. That's impossible. Therefore, the entire purpose of arrogance is impossible. And to claim that impossibility, that you can accomplish the impossible, is sheer arrogance. Plain and simple. You know, you can't really confuse the issue, but arrogance does its very best to confuse the issue. And this is the sickness that the world has. It is willing to entertain this confusion about the issue. Now, Jesus Christ is someone who's not willing to entertain any confusion about this issue. Okay, so that's why Jesus is very valuable to us. And there are others too who are unwilling, but Jesus is, it tends to be front and center in a lot of ways at this time. He's unwilling to entertain any confusion about this because there isn't any. Okay, to entertain confusion about this is to remain deluded and remain very vulnerable to arrogance. So his teachings are to help us realize there's no exception to truth. There's no exception to truth. The goal of arrogance is impossible. You can never be perfect in arrogance because arrogance is a denial of perfection. Okay. You can't do it. It's impossible. It's impossible. And there's no exception to this. There's no exception. Nobody is exempt from the impossibility of arrogance being perfect, having perfection within arrogance. No one is exempt. No one is exempt. No exceptions to this. So when you might say, well, what if I wanted to hang out or, you know, be a friend with Jesus? Well, what are you going to get? You're going to get this adamant. There's no exception to truth. Okay. And there's no confusion over this issue. There's no confusion between what is true and what is impossible. There's no confusion in Jesus. He's not entertaining any confusion. He's not willing to. He's not willing to allow this issue to be confused in his mind. His mind's very clear about it. So that's all. That's all. And the more that we feel comfortable with this adamant clarity, the less frightened we get about Jesus. We say, oh, why should I be afraid? I see it the same way. There's no confusion. It's cut and dried. The goal of arrogance is impossible. Cut and dried. That's it. Reality is perfect, and arrogance we can never be perfect within arrogance because arrogance is a denial of perfection. Arrogance is a lie. We can never be comfortable with a lie. We can never say, oh, this is a perfect lie. Perfect lie? Why? It's always vulnerable to truth, isn't it? All lies are always vulnerable to truth because truth remains perfect. And so when we say that we've perfected a lie, meaning that we think that we've changed reality into imperfection, well, the perfection of reality gives the lie to this belief. So beliefs always are very vulnerable. So we do have this massive worldwide extreme epidemic taking place, and I feel like an epidemiologist doctor trying to fight this, but I don't. I'm trying to rally everyone to say, wow, let's not sink down into this projection. Now, a lot of people may be thinking, wow, it's so difficult, it's only difficult if you don't work at it. If you fall in the projection, then of course it seems difficult because you're not working at it. You might say, well, how can I get free of all this projection? Well, stop projecting so much. Start working. Start working on repentance. That's how you do it. But projection seems so much easier. You know, it's like a drug. It's like, take this drug. You want to feel altered consciousness? Oh, sure, just use this drug. Easy, right? It's the easy way out, it seems. But as we all know, that way of the easy way out, it isn't a way, is not a way out at all, so it's not really easy. Really, the real easiness is the spiritual path because it is a way out. It's a way of setting down our arrogance. It's a way of recognizing we're not in any competition with God at all. And perfection is perfect, and that's not arrogant. I just see a big bird come down. I think so. Beautiful day today here. Finally. It's amazing the attitudes that we hear in this world. Truly amazing. So, again, one of the big questions is people, a lot of Christians, a lot of people around the world think that they're going to be with Jesus at some point soon, etc. Well, great. How do you quote-unquote be with Jesus? Well, Jesus is truth. There's no arrogance in Jesus. But, well, we get comfortable by working on setting down our own arrogance. Now, this doesn't mean we say, oh, I'm a terrible, terrible, miserable human being, and God hates me and stuff. No, that's arrogance, because God created us perfect. We're perfect. We're actually perfect. Not perfect because we're projecting our imperfections on someone else. That's not perfection. See, arrogance tells us to take all our so-called imperfections, which are totally arrogant to say we have imperfections actually, and project them on someone else and say, no, though I see the imperfections, they're with you. So what Jesus tells us is, don't see any imperfection anywhere. Seeing imperfection anywhere is arrogance. And when you see it, you'll project it. You'll say, wow, okay, how do I get free of this imperfection? Oh, okay, I don't have it, but you do. You know, the others have the imperfections. But the truth of the matter is that God created us all absolutely perfect. We're absolutely free. So it's not about saying, hey, you know, I see faults in others, and that's where the imperfection is. It's about seeing perfection everywhere, actually. Now, obviously, the fault of arrogance has to be pointed out. Okay, so when you're talking about fault, it means it's a temporary problem. Okay, it's a problem that has to be let go. It's arrogance. So you can't just say, well, I don't recognize anyone as arrogant. You know, that doesn't quite help us. So we do have this problem of listening to the vice of arrogance. But the vice of arrogance will tell us that see imperfection in others and not in yourself. Whereas the vice of the Holy Spirit will say, there's a way for you to see perfection everywhere. There's where you don't see any imperfection at all. You experience the perfection. Now, does arrogance make us imperfect? It does not. It does not. It's like a dream. Does a dream make the dreamer imperfect? Does a dream of imperfection make the dreamer imperfect? No. No, it does not. So the fact that we're arrogant doesn't mean that we're imperfect. It just means that we believe we're imperfect. It just means we believe we're imperfect. Because we believe that reality is imperfect, and we are reality. We're equal to God. We're one with reality. So we're believing that we're imperfect. Does that make us imperfect? No, it doesn't. Does it mean that we're not experiencing ourselves as perfect? Yes, it does. It does mean that. It means that we are denying ourselves the experience of our perfection. It's like we're in a sleep, so to speak. We don't believe it. We're trying to attack it. We're trying to attack our perfection. So And so this is very clear to those who were not trapped in level confusion, whereas arrogance will get all confused with this. No, wait a minute. So arrogance gets easily confused, very easily confused, and then upset and indignant and then projecting, as you see, you know. Whereas repentance does not get confused by this, does not get all riled up in the mind, you know, stays calm. No trouble. And arrogance insists, no, you're crazy. How can you be calm there? You must be projecting. So it gets it backwards. So truly getting free from arrogance is a very challenging situation. And yet it's the only challenge there is for us, actually. And we try to engage in all these other challenges, make up all these different challenges as if that's what's important. And it's not. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. We keep projecting the challenge of setting arrogance down onto other challenges. For example, like right now, there's a big basketball game getting ready to start here in the Bay Area. Golden State Warriors against the Houston Rockets. And the Golden State Warriors could be going on to the NBA basketball, you know, the championship round, playing for the championship. So we project onto that importance of winning and losing. It's a challenge. We want to see this challenge. We want to see, can they meet this challenge? Or will the Rockets come back and meet their challenge? And so this is an example of projecting challenge. And it's not just sporting contests, okay? This is a stereotype of thinking, well, sports fans, you know, they're projecting their challenge. It's challenges in many, many ways. It's many, many ways. In fact, this whole world, you might say, is represents trivial challenges. People take up all sorts of challenges. Can I do this? Can I do this? And the one challenge that most of us avoid is the challenge of setting arrogance down. We never get around to it. And we say, well, I was taking on difficult challenges my whole life. Yeah, but that was all for the purpose of avoiding the one challenge that we had to have, you have to do. So someone advised me, well, take up golf. That's a real big challenge. And I found out, yeah, it is. And they say, it's a lifelong challenge. You can stay challenged with golf your entire life. And I said, yeah, I see. But I said, but that's not the challenge that I'm supposed to be engaged in. So I see so many people being engaged in all sorts of challenges. And avoiding the one challenge that they must undertake. So what is the difference between someone who is free and is enlightened and is recognizes there's no confusion, they've recognized perfection? Well, they took up the challenge and they didn't get sidetracked by other challenges. At least they tried to minimize it. When I realized, hey, you know, I've got to finish this challenge, I cannot be taking a bunch of other challenges on. It's too difficult. So then the world may look at you like, wow, you're not really challenging yourself, you know. What? Because you're not engaged in all these others of distractions of challenges that are distractions. And they think, oh, you're just, what, taking it easy? You're not doing anything with your life? And see, they don't recognize the one challenge, the all-important challenge of setting your arrogance down. They don't recognize that. So they think you're doing nothing. So it's very difficult. You know, you have to be very humble on this path because others will not necessarily think you're doing anything. I mean, I've been so surprised my whole life here of people, you know, I wherever I go, I walk around and nobody pays me any attention whatsoever. Nobody pats me on the back, nothing. And I think, well, I'm doing nothing. I mean, from their eyes, I'm a nobody doing nothing at all. And I say, what, you know, what in the world is going on with them? I'm intensely engaged in tremendous effort to meet this challenge. Challenge of Jesus, challenge that we cannot escape. Basically, the challenge of Jesus means he said, look, you cannot escape this challenge. Take my word for it. Okay. And if you want to, for my word to be in blood, then I'll do it for you. Okay. This is the ancient way. The ancients were quite bloodthirsty. Let's keep that in mind. I mean, the Canaanites, the old Canaanite religions, and I mean, they engage in a massive amount of child sacrifice. And they also, like when in battle, they'd have two different tribes going to battle. This is something the ancient history utilized. They said, wait a minute. They said, look, instead of us wiping each other out, we're trying to determine, you know, who's stronger, who's better to lead. So, let us nominate some champions from our ranks, and the strongest and the best fighters, and we will pit them against one another. And whoever wins that challenge, then the other side will agree that they've dominated, and then they have to follow, you know, the authority of the winners. And so that way you avoided just massive slaughter on all both sides. And so they would look for a champion, a hero, and then they'd seal oaths in blood. You know, they'd seal oaths in blood that, and the greater the oath, the more blood was required to demonstrate, you know, that you were not trying to fool anybody, that you were serious and you were honest about it. You know, like they said the story about Abraham is that Abraham was willing to sacrifice his son Isaac and tried to demonstrate to God his fidelity. See, that kind of thing. So yeah, I'll kill my son. That's how serious I am, trying to prove to you that I'm willing to sacrifice something that's very precious to me, because your advice is even more precious. So when Jesus is telling us the truth about our arrogance here, people said, you know, Jesus, this is the most unbelievable thing we've ever heard. And we require a sign from you that you're just not pulling our leg here, okay? That you're just not some arrogant projector, okay? And so what you're saying is so unbelievable to us, so astonishing to us, that, you know, we require not that you sacrifice your son ourselves, that you sacrifice yourself, that to prove to us that you're being honest with us. Sacrifice something that's most precious to seal the deal, that we can then trust you. And so they say he gave us life, you know, gave us life to prove, to show, yeah, I'm not deceiving you. So it's hard to get into the minds of the ancients. I have a hard time. I'm still trying, and then, because. But we can look at it like children. I remember children, they like to do blood oaths, like you cut yourself, and it shows that you're dedicated. You seal the deal in blood, whatever. I guess it's a way. The ancients felt that blood gave life, that it's not the body, it's the blood that's life. And so when they do an oath, they want to say, let's give life to this oath, let's give life to this agreement, let's give life to it. So how do you give life? By shedding your blood upon it, by shedding your blood upon it, because then you have put your life upon the document, the agreement, whatever, however they make the agreements. So what they said was, Jesus, you need to shed your blood upon this covenant you have with us, or this challenge, to give life to it, to give life to it. Pretty strange stuff, but that was the times. And they said, we need all of your life in on this, because the challenge seems to be so amazing. How can we really trust you unless you give all your blood to it, so to speak, you know, your life to this challenge? So Jesus said, okay, I'll go along with the times that they lived in. Those were very, very strange times, in many ways. And not that these aren't strange times too. Absolutely they are. But it's very difficult to understand the advice and beliefs of arrogance. It's very difficult. And yet, anyway, they demanded this of Jesus. They say, wow, you want us to enter into this deal, this challenge that you've given us? You want us to believe that this challenge is possible? Well, how in the heck can it be possible? Why don't you prove to us that you believe it's possible? Why don't you put your blood into it? You know, you want us to put our blood into this? Well, you put your blood in first, that kind of thing. You put your blood in first, and then, so this is the way they thought. You call us this new birth, this new life. Well, put your blood into this belief. Let's see you do that first. And so Jesus said, okay, I'll go first. I'll put, you know, we dare you. And he said, okay, I'll do it. And then when he did it, people are like, wow. That really, it really carried weight with them, you know, back then, that somebody would, you know, sacrifice their life for this. It carried emotional, convincing weight back then. Now these days, you know, it probably wouldn't carry any weight at all. I mean, when everybody said, "What the heck are you doing? That's ridiculous," but back then it carried a lot of weight. And they said, well, now, see, now I can believe you, because you were willing to die for it and shed your blood upon it and pour your blood into this, what you call as a new life. And so we believe that you believed in it, and we can trust you, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, then the resurrection made him feel also, wow, you know, you do get a new life out of that. So there's so much blood sacrifice in the ancient times that they thought in this way. They really thought in this way. They thought God demanded, you know, blood sacrifice. It's so difficult to understand this ideology. The more you drop arrogance, the more difficult it is to comprehend this. You know, it's just very difficult. But I'm trying to, you know, get the picture, keep working on it, and why people were so convinced. Well, so they felt they needed to be convinced some way, you know, that in order to believe that they could put arrogance down. Let's just make it simple. They said, wow, is this really even possible for us? You're saying it's possible? Is this challenge even, can we even do it? And they felt they needed to be convinced that they weren't being deceived. So Jesus, they demanded the death of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, okay, as their proof. So Jesus gave it to him. Now I'm not demanding that proof from Jesus at all. I said, I'll find the proof within the, you know, the clarity of the one mind. You know, work at it that way. not demanding anyone, a sacrifice of anyone. But we've come a long ways from that sacrificial mindset of prove it to me, prove it to me. Well, I mean, the way that Jesus has proven it to me, for instance, is A Course in Miracles, and Journey Beyond Words. That's a very strong proof, because it's proof through reason. Not through sacrifice, but through reason. Jesus said, hey, this body's not our real life. You know, and they said, really? Well, if you don't think the body's important, then let's see you die then. Why don't you just die? And so he said, okay. I'll agree to that, you know. Whatever it takes, whatever you want to get you going on this. You know, I'll do whatever you want to get you going on this. So his body wasn't anything to him. He said, okay, it's not a problem. You want that, fine. But we've already got going on this now, and we don't need that kind of sign, you know. We say, look, we know that you're right. Okay, we get it. You proved your point. He's already proved this point. We don't need to ask them to do it again. Let's work on it now to clarify. We already took the challenge up. Let's finish the challenge. As a way of just streamlining it. You know, who knows what proof people ask for throughout history. Has been all sorts of different crazy stuff. Very crazy stuff. Yeah. Now, this epidemic that's raging throughout the world, how do we do anything about this? I don't know. You know, you try not to get infected yourself, right? I mean, it's really what we were told about the end times is the end times would be such a wicked and adulterous generation of projectionists, really, those who are so believing in the arrogance of projection and the perfection of arrogance that even those who have been taking up the challenge that Jesus gave us and setting our arrogance down, even those will be in danger of getting infected by this most terrible plague. And I certainly feel that way. Everyone I go around to and talk with, they're all infected with it. They're all zombies. You know, it's horrible. Some worse than others. Some worse than others, that is for sure. So what do we do? I mean, this is, I keep knocking on the door of Jesus, say, what do we do? I mean, this is a bad situation here. The idea that we can perfect arrogance is a most terrible path, and the leaders of this world really are leading us like Pied Pipers down that path, and they have a massive amount of followers now, actually, massive amount. Now, they're not all bad. I mean, just because someone is projecting severely, you know, it doesn't mean they're terrible, wicked people. I mean, they may seem to be very friendly, humorous, nice people. At least their image, they may have a very nice image, and they may do some things that are good and right. You know, I've been critical of the Pope. The Pope doesn't. That doesn't mean everything the Pope does is wrong. The Pope is trying the best he can, under his beliefs, is the belief system. I believe he's going in the wrong direction, but it doesn't mean everything he says is wrong. No, not at all. He may be trying to please both arrogance. I believe this is the problem, trying to please both arrogance and truth. You know, this is the trap we fall into, of a compromise. So he's really fighting a sort of a compromise, taking a compromise position and urging Catholics to also take a compromise position, thinking that, you know what, this is how we protect ourselves from, you know, this is how we can get along and go forward. Because the world is so infected with arrogance now and projection that we feel like, oh, how can we go forward? And so it seems like compromise is the way. Compromise is never the way. Compromise is, again, sheer arrogance. Compromise is sheer arrogance. It's like saying, well, both lies and true are true. How can you say that it's both true, that reality is perfect and it's not perfect? And then claim, well, you know, that's good. Well, if you take this position, you'll end up having to project to you'll end up getting pulled into all sorts of projection to defend this indefensible position you have. It's indefensible. And then you get all frightened, and you think you're going to end up in mental chaos because of this, so you try to defend it. And so it's the Good Shepherd does not teach a compromised teaching. It says, hey, look, we got to put up with these knuckleheads who are trying to perfect arrogance, but that doesn't mean that we're teaching a compromise with arrogance. It does not mean that. It means basically that we've accepted that what Jesus told us is true, that we must set down arrogance, and we are perfect. We are the Son of God. We were created perfect. There's nothing we need to do to establish our perfection. We are perfect through the creation of God, through the absolute perfection of God being the creator. God created us in his likeness and image, which means perfection, which means absolute perfect freedom. So when we say God created us in his image, we mean as spirit, as truth, as freedom, as perfection. That's what we are. We can't change that. We cannot change that. There's no way we can change that. So trying to perfect arrogance is not the way to go. But you have some in this world, quite a few, who have worked really hard on trying to perfect their arrogance. And so they seem like great leaders to us. They seem like, wow. You know, it's very seductive of people. They think, oh, wow, why is that person think are so self-confident that somehow they have some capability to, you know, lead us to happiness or something? Wow. Because they've been very much working on trying to perfect arrogance and lying, 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 deceiving, 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 projecting, projecting, projecting. And yet it gets them a long ways in this world because we're seem to be patsies for that. But those who've worked on the path of true forgiveness and humility, setting arrogance down, it's not so difficult to see through it. I mean, for me, I can look like 10 minutes. I can just tell whoever it is, even if someone's very, very skilled in arrogance and projection. I can just see their mind and just say, oh, okay, that's a mind of arrogance and projection. Okay, it's easy to see it. Even the most skillful. So it's not difficult. And the trouble is when you deal with that type, you can become very confused, because arrogance tries to confuse the issue between truth and lies, and you can become feeling very confused, very lost, very fearful, very guilty. Then you can be projected on easily if you're all confused, and you think, okay, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe if I just agree to go along with their agenda, that I can escape this. I won't be confused anymore. I'll be in the right. See, because they're claiming that they're in the right. They're the righteous ones. The righteous ones. If you just do this, you'll feel good about yourself. So people say, wow, yeah, that's the only way I'm going to feel good about myself. But you're really, they call it selling your soul to the devil, basically. You're selling it to this agenda of arrogance, to try and perfect arrogance, which you have to use then projection. You have to use projection. There's no choice. And guilt, you know, guilt. How can you project unless you're projecting on someone and claiming they're guilty? You have to see, so you require someone to project upon, and you'll end up trying to split your own mind into good and bad, so you can project, the good can project upon the bad and saying, you're there's where the bad is. And how else can you try to perfect arrogance, which is really claiming there's no such thing as perfection? How else? You have to be engaged in the battle of good and bad. You got no choice. So you end up dissociating your mind, as it were, into good and bad aspects, and then the good attacks the bad and tries to claim that it can attain perfection and arrogance through destroying half the mind, or destroying, getting rid of half the mind. Well, if the mind's perfect, how can you get rid of half the mind? How can there be a bad part of the mind? No, this is all a dream of duality. It's a dream of duality. So once again, we go back to the question, what can we do about this extreme plague upon this planet? And is it possible to even turn this plague back? I don't know. This is the question I've been asking Jesus over and over. I still don't have a response. Now, if he said yes, okay, say, okay, well then let's start doing it. What do we need to do? You know, I don't know. If he says no, then I say, okay, well, what do we do then? If I don't want to I don't want to just sit here in this world like a sitting duck and just get projected upon and, and keep trying to withstand all this dodge, all this massive projection that's taking place. That's no fun at all. What kind of life is that? There have been some great, great saints in this world whose minds are absolutely free of arrogance, who accepted the perfection of reality, who absolutely accepted the perfection of reality. There's been a number of them in the 20th century, actually. Did they cure the situation? No, the plague is like completely out of control right now. Did they give hope to some in this world? Yes, absolutely. But so they didn't stem the tide of the projection that, we're flooded. We're all flooded. The river's flooded. We're on our rooftops right now and saying, hey, Jesus, is the flood bar, are the flood bars ever going to go down? Come on. What do we do here? Where's the helicopters? Yeah, I mean, where's the boats? I mean, we're on our rooftops right now. And the floodwaters are getting higher and higher. This is the trouble. We're on the very toppermost of our roofs, and the floodwaters are rising still more and more and more. Every day, you look at the floodwaters, oh my gosh, they've risen another foot. This is shocking. Now, for me again, I don't have enough work. I don't have enough work. This is a very tough situation. So, oh my gosh, what do I do? How can I keep going? And I think a lot of people are feeling like, how do I keep functioning here? How do I keep going? I'm on the rooftop. I'm on the rooftop. I don't want to be pulled into the waters of arrogance. I've worked too hard to undo it, and to not get confused over this issue. So the ancients, their reasoning abilities were not very good. I mean, they were kind of lost in arrogance to such an extent. They demanded some sort of very dramatic, arrogant proof. Pour out your blood. Prove it to us. You'd say you can do this. Prove you're not a liar. Pour out your blood on this, on us. Pour out your blood on us so that we may have a token of your sincerity, So, but nowadays we should have a lot better capacity of reasoning, and so we say, "Ah, no, we don't need any of that. Just pour out your reason upon us, pour out your clarity upon us, pour out your friendship upon us. That's all we need. We don't need your blood, blood of a body, or the body's blood of a body. We could, that's not going to prove anything. Prove that we can work it through all the way to see." To see the truth of it, prove that. And so I've tried to insist upon that sort of proof, that prove that we can get it very clear in our minds. And I've gotten, gotten pretty far along with that. But again, how is that going to solve anything? I've not, I've yet to see how does that turn the tide here. I'm just being honest. I don't see. I know there have been saints in the world recently, very, very profound saints, super saints. Did they turn the tide? I'm not seeing it. I don't see it at all. I have not seen it at all. So this again is a question that is obvious when we're on the rooftops. You obviously say, "Hey, wait a minute. What is that? Are the floodwaters going to drop? And subside, or are we going to get a helicopter take us off our rooftops here, or are we going to grow wings and fly? Maybe we need. Are we going to learn how to float in the air? Maybe we need to. Maybe we can just fly, float off of our rooftops." That's one possibility, actually. Maybe we just better start floating like this, spiritually floating, where, or maybe we need to start walking on water. The floodwaters are coming up. Maybe we just walk on the water. But who wants to live in a world that's flooded with projection and arrogance and unwillingness? the overall trend in this world is to try and perfect arrogance. There's no question about that. And this is what we were warned about. And this is a generation that has said, basically came in and said, hey folks, you don't need religion, you don't need repentance, you don't need the tough work of religion. It's very tough work. It's a great challenge. You don't need to spend your lifetime, you know, in this great challenge. There's so much other stuff you could be doing, having fun with in this world. You know, why don't you just go out and have fun? And don't worry, we'll teach you. It's easy. Just work towards perfecting arrogance. We have all these gadgets, but that'll help you. We have computers, you know, whatever. We'll help you perfect arrogance. We can perfect arrogance. They say we've gone a long way towards it. You know, look how confident we are. So they bring this message to this world. You know, it's a very seductive message. And they basically are attacking religion as much as they possibly can, because this represents a threat to them. Because, you know, what some people here don't believe that we can perfect arrogance, so that really undermines our belief. It makes us feel a little bit nervous about it, so they want to get rid of that. Who wants to live in such a place, I think, where, you know, wow, this doesn't have anything for me. Doesn't this world? And the idea is like, go out and have fun. And what do you mean have fun in this world? Really? I mean, how fun is it? It's really not that fun. There's really nothing you can do in this world that's that fun. Yeah, it's basically I could really look in hindsight. I said, take it or leave it. You know, it wasn't that big a deal. If I hadn't have done any of this stuff, no big loss for me at all. Really. Oh, I want to go see some waterfall somewhere. Some mountain peak or, you know, whatever, travel around. Well, what's the big deal, really? What's the big deal? Still got to circulate the blood in my body, right? Still have to breathe. It still get dirty. Have to take a bath. Still have to go to the bathroom. I mean, still have to sleep. I mean, why? Do I go see some mountain somewhere? I don't have to sleep anymore? It's like, you know, sleep's a terrible problem for me. Always has been a hideous problem. I thought that my problems are going to vanish because I go hiking and see some waterfall, go to Yosemite and see the mountains. And what's the big deal? What's the big deal? It's very superficial. So all these challenges that we take up are very superficial. Yeah, let me try to challenge myself, do this. I'm going to challenge myself, see how fast I can play the guitar or something. Well, what's that going to do for me? Well, the people say, oh, you're really good. You really took up that challenge. I said, but what's the big deal? I mean, I still have sleep problems, so come on. So what's the big deal with this world anyway? But this is a world of distraction. So those who want to be distracted put a great value on this world, because they say, well, there's so many ways I can challenge my body. You know, so many ways. Let me see if I can swim from Alcatraz to the shoreline of San Francisco. Let me see if I can run a marathon. You know, let me challenge the body. What the heck does that bring you? It's ridiculous. The body's still the body. You know, we're still deluded in arrogance. That's not the challenge that we're supposed to take. So, but those who are arrogant and want to distract, trying to perfect arrogance, they this world is like, oh, I gotta have this world. I just gotta have it. They value it so much, because there's so having a body in a world is so valuable to them, because they can distract themselves on so many superfluous challenges everywhere. Gosh, let me see if I can do this. Let me see if I can do that. It's endless. Just look at YouTube and all these challenges that people are trying to do. Can I do this? Can I do this? And they just keep inventing more challenges, more games, more of this. Let me challenge myself in some way. And they're avoiding the one challenge that we do have to take up. So this world is like an excellent place to divert, you know, your attention from taking up the one challenge. It's a great place to be irresponsible. This is how I see it. I see the world as being extremely irresponsible. There's only a few in this world who are really being responsible. And they know who they are, because they know the tough work that they've put into it. Taking up the challenge is a very tough challenge. Arrogance seems to be so strong and boastful and such a bully. It's such an intimidator. It'll threaten you in so many ways, and so you put you through the ringer. You know, it's not that much fun, but it is very interesting. It's very interesting. You say, wow, this is really worthy. This challenge is worthy of me. This other stuff is not really worthy of me. I mean, it isn't. You ask yourself if what the stuff you're doing and challenging, is it really worthy of you? You know, You know, you're better than that. We're all way better than that. We're better than this world. We don't need this world. We don't need this body. We're better than a body. We don't need to challenge ourselves or trying to keep our, let me see if I can keep my body alive through, you know, through this challenge. We're better than that. It's not worthy of us at all. But the challenge of setting down arrogance, well, you say, wow, we're worthy of that one. Because that's a tricky son of a gun, to say the least. And we really have tried to imprison ourselves to an extraordinary extent. And so getting free of all this delusion, that's quite a challenge. So we try to feel worthy, try to make challenges worthy of us, but the only one that's really worthy of us is setting down this arrogance. And so for me, that's why I'm able to walk this world and still keep my head up, you know, because I haven't really succeeded in any challenge in the world, really, except, you know, to take up this challenge of setting arrogance down. I don't have any degrees or diplomas or awards or, you know, people say, what have you done? Where's your money? Show us, you know, that you've, the challenge of becoming rich. I don't have any. What can I say? Where's your success? You know, challenge of being successful. I don't have any. And yet I still carry myself like I'm very worthy. Like I've accepted some really worthy challenge. Well, I have. That's because I have. But people don't see it that way. They think, well, you're being arrogant because you feel confident and successful. But we don't see any basis for that. So they think I'm arrogant. I say, no, it's not true. Setting down arrogance makes me feel worthy, that this is a worthy challenge to take up. I say, what do you mean? I don't see that. I don't see that one. I don't see that one. They tell you, you know, retire, take up flying, you know, take up new challenges. You have opportunities to take all these challenges on. And I say, well, what are you talking about? I'm not interested in any of that stuff. So I don't even need to retire here. I don't even need those golden years of retirement. You know, I've been focused on this challenge my whole life, of the challenge of setting arrogance down. And that's the only challenge I need. Don't need any others. So the idea of this world as being valuable, I don't see it as valuable. I don't need it. Don't need it. Body, is a body valuable? Not really. Why? The challenge is to keep it alive, you know? Is that a worthy challenge for the Son of God to be trying to keep a body alive? That's crazy. Trying to keep feeding, breathing. Oh, I got to keep this body that's falling apart. I got to keep it alive, you know? And can you function even though when you're old and the body's completely decrepit and stuff? Can you function that way? That's another challenge I think is important. So, of course, we agree to have this body challenge of the body getting older, and what things can we do as we get older? Can we still, you know, swim? Can we still run? Can we still do this? Can we still do that? And this is the obsession of the world. The world's obsessed with all these challenges, and most of them are completely oblivious to the challenge of setting down arrogance. They don't even realize that there's such a challenge that even exists. They say, what are you talking about? We're our purpose is to perfect arrogance, not to set it down. You're crazy. Oh. You cannot perfect arrogance. This is what I found out. So I found out the truth about arrogance. And once you find out, then you never go back. It's finished. It's finished. So I got no friend. I got no choice but to be a friend of Jesus. I got no choice in the matter, actually. Once you see the falsity of arrogance and you cannot perfect it, then you realize, wow, if I can't perfect it, then there's no point to it at all. I have to set it down. Otherwise, I'm just going to continue horrible suffering. So I got no choice but to be a friend of Jesus. It's out of my hands. It got to be. So might as well, you know, accept it. Yeah. So this is why I work on it. Not out of arrogance, but out of a lack of arrogance. Out of realizing that I cannot perfect arrogance. It's impossible. Only arrogance believes that arrogance can be perfected. But I found out that there's within us, there's a reason, there's truth within us. And the truth experiences that you cannot perfect. Arrogance is impossible. So where can we go once we realize that it's impossible to perfect arrogance? You have to go back to truth. That's where Jesus is, abiding in truth. That, and there are others who abide in truth. The tribal mentality of the past was all about winning, and their provincialism was so strong. You know, it was just amazing, the ancients, that they had a little tribe living on a hilltop, and their world was this hilltop and that hilltop over there. That's pretty much. And if you dominated, you know, those winning dominated those others over there, you were number one in the world. You were number one. And that's it. And so, you know, the ruler of this little hilltop fort, the ones that the great warrior who defeated that other hilltop over there, you know, they're the chosen one of God. Okay, they're the only one. There's only one, you know, winner. And this little hilltop here is the winner over that little hilltop over there. So there's a very strong tendency in the past that whatever champion they had, in whatever way they insisted, this is the only champion there is. This is God's champion. And there is no other champion. Because why? They're afraid that the other hilltop over there might get a champion. God might give them a champion too. And then so when you go out to fight, two champions are fighting, oh my goodness, you know, maybe that champion will defeat our champion and then we'll be losers. So what they tried to do is they tried to intimidate their enemy. You know, this is very potent in the past. They used tricks to try to demoralize their opponent. And so when they won, they would say, hey, God gave our champion the power to defeat you. That's why we won. And God likes us better than likes you. Therefore, you cannot get a good champion. It's impossible for you. Because the grace and power of God is with our champion, not with you. And so they try to demoralize their opponents this way. So and it worked. You know, demoralizing your opponent is gamesmanship, and it's very powerful. And in the past, they used that to a tremendous extent. And so basically they said, look, Jesus is the champion of God. God gave us this champion, and there is no other champion. That permeated, still permeated their beliefs that they needed to demoralize others in order to stay champions, stay winners. So they view Jesus as this is the winner, okay? And this is the champion. God gave us a champion. It defeats you. But you can never, ever cause us any trouble anymore because God is not with you. It's only with us. Only with us. So this provincial attitude of having a champion and demoralizing your opponent by claiming they can never get a good champion. This is what they hope for. See, because in the constant warfare, tribal warfare of the past, which it was virtually constant, is horrible. What did everybody want? They wanted permanency of their winning. They wanted to win, and they wanted that winning to be permanent. Okay? They wanted to be permanent. They didn't want the tribe next door to come up with some big champion who would say, hey, God has told me that I have the right to your land, and I'm the champion of God, and we're going to take your land from you. They didn't want that, of course. They'd say, oh, holy cow, here we go again. So they wanted to win in battle and say, guess what? You're defeated, and you're defeated, eternally defeated, and you will never get a champion from God because God hates you, and God loves only us and not you, and so our champion is the only one. There can never be another. You know, that's it. This is very demoralizing. They try to demoralize. So ancient kingdoms, and we still do it to this day. We're more sophisticated about demoralizing one another, but they are very direct and blatant about it. So the belief that Jesus is the only one who is free of arrogance, there's no other, you know, is this ancient attempt to demoralize your opponent. Okay. There are many who have been free of arrogance, and many who freed themselves from arrogance. You have no choice. Everybody has to free themselves. You cannot perfect arrogance. It's impossible. So I will be free of arrogance at some point. You will be free of arrogance. Everyone will be free of arrogance. You have no choice in the matter. You all abide with Jesus and all those who have freed themselves from arrogance. No choice in the matter whatsoever. But it certainly is helpful if you don't get caught up in this provincialism of trying to demoralize. You don't win through demoralizing, quote unquote, your opponents. That's not how you win. You win through setting your arrogance down through clarity and reason and clarity and your own repentance. Now, Hitler did that in World War II, Operation Barbarossa, for instance, broke the treaty, secret treaty with Stalin, and then went into Russia, invaded Russia after the Battle of Britain failed. And he told his generals before this operation, look, kill everybody. Okay, whatever you, prisoners of war, kill them. Kill everybody you can. He says, show no mercy to anyone. And he said, look, this will end up demoralizing the country, and it'll be a milder situation once we conquer. We want it to be mild. In other words, we don't want them rising up and eventually pushing back to us. So that it's how do you demoralize your enemy? So they thought that, killing, prisoners of war, that's killed so many of them, Soviet prisoners of war, that would work. It didn't work. It didn't work. It didn't work so well. They got even more feisty, But any time you're conquering, trying to conquer someone, thinking that God gave you this land, you have a right to conquer it. It's yours. This is all psyching yourself up. Is you tell the warriors. So what do you want to tell the warriors if you want to capture some land for yourself and say, well, the guys over there is more fertile land, and we're living here in this rocky land. They have this real fertile land. Wow, if we stay here, we're going to keep suffering for a long time. Huh? What do we do about this? You know what? Maybe we could go in and take that land over for ourselves. Okay, so then you start looking around, telling the young people, start educating them. He says, guess what? God told us that we're entitled to this land because we're better people than those people down there. Those people are bad people, and we're better people. And they say, well, really? Why are we better? I say, huh, why are we better? Okay, let's make some rules and regulations. We need to do this and this and this. And God gave us these rules, and we're following the rules, and that makes us superior to those people over there. And so then you tell the warriors class, you raise up these warriors, okay, and they're, that's what you want, to seize the land. And you tell them, God has told you that you're better than them, and then God is with you, and you're going to win. God is with you, and you're going to win, and God is not with them, therefore they're going to lose. Okay, so see, if you're telling some warriors to go out there and risk their lives in a battle, first you tell them that God is with you and you can't lose because God has already ordained you're going to win, because we've been told, but God told us that we deserve this land. It's our land. It's God's land, and we have, and so God will enable you to take it from them. You also have to convince the warriors that the other side is going to lose, because the warrior might be saying, "Okay, great. But what if God is with that other side too?" Because their reason is telling them, wait a minute, this, I'm, so you have to say, no, God is not with that other side. No way. There's only one side that is right, our side. God is not with them. So we have the right to conquer. Don't worry. And then the warriors feel very confident. They say, oh, I'm not afraid. We're going to win. It's already ordained, preordained. We're going to win. And the other side deserves to lose. It's actually been preordained they're going to lose for sure. And so then they go into battle with this great confidence. So they were always, in the ancient times, always battles between these various gods back then. Our God is greater than your God. It was a psych game that they were engaged in. They're trying to psych each other out. And when one side would win, they said, our God told us we would win. Promised us we would win, and look, we won. Our God knows the truth. Your God doesn't. You thought you would win. You'd lost. Therefore, your God's a false God, and you will never succeed with that God. Our God is the only true God, and your God is a losing liar. So we win, you lose. And then they tried to demoralize them because we wanted to be enslaved, and say you were born slaves. Your purpose is now to be slaves to us. This is what happened in the ancient times. I mean, let's be honest about ancient times and these times that we live in. To be honest about it, it has been ridiculous. God plays no favors whatsoever. God does not enter into any covenants whatsoever. God never says this is belongs to you and doesn't belong to someone else. God gives you absolute perfect freedom, gives you everything. Everything belongs to everyone. What are we? We're spirit. We're formless spirit. We're free. We're absolutely free to experience all as spirit, as formless idea, okay, as essence. This is reality. God doesn't have any favorites or any preferences. God created us perfect, perfectly free, perfectly invulnerable, all of us. So we have just been engaged in this incredible silliness throughout history. We, you know, it really is something to look back upon and laugh about, how silly it's been. And they still do that in sporting contests, you know, in not only that, but in all sorts of status contests, etc. It's a sight game is being played. Is, you know, that, hey, you know, we're going to pray to our God, God's going to help us win. And we know that, you know, the other side, God is not with them. They're bad, they're evil, they're, you know, they've broke taboos, they've broken the laws of God, so God can't be with them. See, this is part of the psych job, is saying God has these laws, and these other people broke the laws, therefore they deserve annihilation. The penalty of breaking laws is to be annihilated. So we're just doing God's work here, God's vengeance upon those who broke God's laws. And so we're completely righteous and justified in doing this. And like Hitler said to the generals, you got to drop your scruples. You know, he said, you're justified in this. He tried to convince them that to drop their scruples because there was honor among warriors. There's honor among warriors, you see. And Hitler disregarded this honor among warriors. You know, he wasn't a warrior. He wasn't of the warrior class. He was of the petty bourgeois projectionist class, of the tribe of severe projection. He was engaged in severe projection, projecting his own, you know, failures to perfect arrogance onto others, and then blaming for them for that. So the warriors had, you know, whoops, what did I do? Okay. The warriors have scruples and honor on the battlefield because they know how awful it is. And, you know, they think, hey, you know, it could have gone the other way. You know, they're more pragmatists. It's often the demagogues and the political, these political leaders that get power through being so arrogant in their projections that they end up telling the warrior class, hey, this is what I'm telling you to do, and this is what the people expect you to do. And the warrior class is saying, hey, wait a minute. I mean, keep in mind the generals tried to assassinate Hitler, okay? I mean, I know the people have blamed Germany very badly, but it was really the terrible program of arrogance and projection that bullied the warrior class. So severely bullied. Hitler was an extreme bully to the generals. A lot of the generals said, this guy's crazy. This guy's terrible. He's a lunatic. We don't want to do this. And they tried to disobey him. And, I mean, he purged them. He had so many generals killed because they wouldn't, you know, go along with his insane arrogance. And so he told the generals, look, you got to set aside the honor of war here. This is a new era. Now we're engaged in this new great program of perfecting arrogance, okay, which is really what Nazism is all about, and which this new world order is all about too. It's just Nazism in without the label of Nazism, actually. It is. And he said, you can't go along with the old ways of look, you fought an honorable battle, the enemy fought honorably, you did too, okay, we've captured you, okay, put you over here, we'll put you in a prison camp, and we'll feed you, and when the war's over, then we'll decide what to do with you. But, you know, and there's all sorts of rules of engagement and combat and that warriors engage in. It's a contest, okay? But these doggone demagogue rulers don't see it that way. They think that they're on a mission from God to perfect arrogance, and that the means, the ends justify the means, that the ends justify the means. So Hitler told the generals, you know, kill everybody. And the generals said, whoa, you know, what are you talking about? And he said, it's a new era, it's a new age, and the ends justify the means, because we're going to rule over the whole world, and we're going to perfect arrogance, and everyone's going to thank us for that, and we need people to be mild towards us, and we don't want all these warriors still, you know, around, so just get, you know, kill them all. And hopefully, you know, a lot of the generals said, well, we're not going to quite, you know, do that. They didn't, of course they didn't want to do that. Warriors have honor. Warriors have honor. It's the demagogues that are the real trouble, real troublesome ones. And I discovered this in a dream that I had. Is those who have not been on the battlefield tend to be the worst ones. And I had this dream that points out who's really pushing this agenda most severely in this world right now. Okay, who's really the one who's pushing this attitude of let's perfect arrogance. Okay, and I do put it at the footstep of these radicals in the world. It's a combination of extreme radicalism, but it's as I say, I have said before, and I say it again, it's largely at the door of the radicals, very severely radical feminists. It absolutely is. It's those who are not part of the warrior class ever, who have not had experience in that. And in this dream, I had this experience. This man was pressuring me with a gun, and he wanted to kill me. And I finally said no. He's trying to bully me into agreeing, you know, to die, and because I was in the way of his agenda. Okay, I was interfering with his agenda of perfection. And I finally said no, I'm not going to. And he backed off. And he said okay. And then I felt that there was a connection that he realized, hey, this guy is very tough warrior here, right here, you know, and he was impressed, and deep down he was saying, wow, what is this? This is some kind of strength I'm not used to, and okay, let's, you know, what do we do now? He said, okay, severe re-education, I need to re-educate you. And I said, I agreed, okay, you know, I, at that point I was still not strong enough to say no to that. But then there was this lady beside him. This woman was beside him, and she was absolutely furious with him. She was screaming at him and railing, and she was projecting this viciousness towards him. Says, "How dare you not do what I told you to do? I told you to have no scruples with this one, no scruples." And this is similar to Hitler telling his generals, "Have no mercy or scruples whatsoever. Execute everybody you come across. Burn everything. Execute everyone." Those were his orders to the generals. Burn everything. Execute everyone. Leave no one alive. Destroy everything. And the general said, you know, that sickens me. I mean, that's just too much. Got a letter. There was a letter from someone on the Eastern Front. A German who he said, my friend just committed suicide because he said, I can't do this. I can't be killing these prisoners. I can't do it. So he, for him, it was better that he commit suicide than to keep carrying out these orders of killing everybody. You know, this is so. In this dream, I saw then that there are this mindset in the world that wants no mercy to be shown here, and that the warrior class, which men have been, of course, the warriors throughout history, and men are not willing to go along to that extent with it. They're not that vicious, whereas the females have not been so much engaged in any of this warriorship. Okay, they're having children and raising children and taking care of a lot of stuff, but they're basically kept out of these massive wars and battles throughout history, because if all the women get killed, how can you replenish the bodies? You cannot. So it's just obviously you cannot do that. And men are more suitable to warfare anyway. So the women have less scruples. They tend to be more ideological, ideologues, demagogues. And what they do, what I saw was that they had put this ideologue in power in the United States. And they're the ones really calling the shots behind the scenes, saying, have no mercy. Have no mercy, have no mercy. We have to perfect arrogance. And so anyone who stands in the way, you must get rid of them. And I saw this man who was trying his best to carry out what he was being told to do, but he had his limits. He had his limits. He said, you know, and this is what I've found in my life too. I've actually had certain situations where I had this women telling their men to kill me. I talked to the men. I said, hey, look, you know, I don't want to be killed, and it's not justified, etc. I said, no. And I talked to them, and they said, okay, we understand. And then they went back to the women. And then the women were just like furious with them and said, no, we told you to kill them. And they said, oh gosh, you know, I can't stand the fury of women, because it could cause my nerves just come fall to pieces, actually. Women, the viciousness of women can cause men to have a nervous breakdown, actually. And it feels worse than death. So then they came back, you know, I had to, you know, had to flee. I've understood that there is this, men will say, wait a minute, let's have some honor here, you know. My opponent is an honorable opponent here. And hey, you know, I win, I lose, I lose. If this opponent is stronger than me, you know, let me respect that, so to speak. And let me listen to what they have to say. Let me listen. Why are they so strong? Because the men are interested. Why is my opponent so strong? I want to find out. And then they start getting interested in that. The women and the radical feminists saying, no, don't get interested in that. What are you doing? You're crazy. You're, you know, you deserve to die. You didn't follow our instructions. No mercy. And so I experienced this whole scenario we have in the world right now and what's really going on. So I know what's going on. There's no question that the radical feminists are really calling the shots behind the scenes now of who gets in power, who gets put into this head of this bureaucracy, head of this department, you know, in a governance, who gets appointed to these positions. They're the ones deciding. And for example, the president is just saying, yes, dear, okay, yes, okay, that's what you want, sure, no problem, that's what you want, oh, of course, okay, I'll do that, you know, as long as I can go play golf, you know, and you know, he's saying, oh, God, I really have to appoint this, I don't really think that's that great, you know, but okay, whatever you say. And then say, I just got to get away from this. This is driving me nuts. My conscience feels terrible. I just got to go play golf, you know, let me go play golf. And it's so. Okay, so that's how it works. It's how it works in this world. I mean, when you basically have someone else telling you what to do, and they're telling you to do stuff that you feel is going to make you look bad, ultimately, that you're being thrown under the bus, ultimately, you just say, oh my gosh, I can't stand this. Let me just go play golf, because golf really helps you forget about everything. Really, there's nothing else quite like golf to make you just completely forget you even exist, because it's like you're sitting there, it's like, how do I make this putt and save a double bogey? And I don't know how to, I'm not sure if I can do it or not. And you become so absorbed in trying to roll that little ball in a little hole, everything else gets blocked out. So when you see someone like a president who just has to play golf all the time, you know, just get away, play golf, like, you know that they're not really calling the shots. You know, it's like Eisenhower had to golf. Well, Eisenhower was actually, as he said, the military-industrial complex is the ones really causing the shots. He became aware he really didn't have the power he thought he did. He did not have the power that he thought he did. That there was this corporate power, as we call it, the military-industrial complex, that had more power than the presidency. It was actually dictating what the heck's going on in the world. And so he just said, oh, man. And also, he knew there's extraterrestrials. See, once Eisenhower realized that big corporations, the military-industrial complex, had been in contact with extraterrestrials for quite some time, and was working with them, and they were working to create this new world order on this planet, and that everything else was just window dressing. And he, you know, Eisenhower said, "Just what the heck? Let me go to Palm Springs and golf." You know, well, you know, I just want to forget about this. I don't really have the power I thought I did. I helped win the war, and I find out that all along that we've been deceived, and that you know, Eisenhower knew about extraterrestrials. He absolutely knew. And he threatened to, of course, take over area, was it 50, Area 51 or 59, whatever it was, Area 51 in Nevada. He said, "You tell me what's going on there, I'm going to send the 10th Infantry and 10th Division in, and we're going to absolutely crush you." And so they told him what's going on there, but they said, "Look, there's nothing you can do about it, because we have these advanced weapons, this advanced technology, and we're going to cause the world to panic if you say anything." And so he basically was caught, trapped. But he did warn us when he left. He said, "Hey, you have a severe threat to this world, believe me." And he called it the military-industrial complex, which is code word for extraterrestrials being involved with this planet. He knew all about it. He absolutely did. As did Kennedy. I'm sure he told Kennedy about it. And as do probably other presidents. Reagan also warned us that the threat comes from space to this world. He knew about it too. But what are you going to do, you know? And so, go golf. Let's go golf. And so, it's often those who have no scruples who end up getting the power around some demagogue. Okay, if we look at Hitler, his Goebbels and Goering and various other nasty, petite bourgeois, non-warrior class people, who ideologues, who you know, well, the final salute, they had no problem saying final solution. Oh yeah, you know, let's just exterminate all the Jews, and that's the answer. They won't bother the great new world order that we have of arrogance. Because who knows? Maybe another Messiah might come from the Jews. Who knows, right? Let's get rid of all the rabbis. Let's get rid of all of those who don't recognize our authority. You know, so these little petty bourgeois, you know, people who had no honor, no scruples, they're the ones who were whispering in Hitler's ear, saying, "Hey, you're so great, you're great, you're great," because he was a demagogue. He was easily aggrandized in his own mind, and it was really this cabal around him, this clique around him of very poisonous ideologies of arrogance, who said, "Look, we're going to use your eloquence." So usually they pick someone who's good at speaking, public speaking. All right, Hitler is very charismatic of public speaking, and so what happens is you have these very vicious people, minds, who believe in perfecting arrogance, who will identify some very charismatic speaker figure. And then they will gradually work on their psychology of this person to convince them that they have some great destiny to be some great political messiah ushering in a new world order. And that this is, you know, what God ordained, and they're the chosen one of God to do this. And but all the while, they're able to manipulate them, saying, "Hey, if you don't do this, you know, you have to do this, but we're going to help you do this, and we're going to explain because we have some help from higher authority too, and we're going to help you out." And they manipulate the weakness of this person, the insecurity of it, you know. Oftentimes, broke person from a broken family. You know, and they have some great insecurities that maybe they're not as good as they think they are, and they basically tell you, you have to win at this. You have to win, otherwise, you know, you're not going to be what we thought you were. And so they're very worried about not succeeding, and so they end up listening to the advice of these handlers. Basically, they're handlers. So you get somebody who's a very thinks they're a great speaker, and everybody wants to hear what I have to say, and then the handlers manipulate them. Manipulate them, manipulate them. They say, "Look, this is what needs to be done. You don't like it, go play golf. It's okay, go play golf." Ring any bells? Ring any bells? This is what's been going on in this world. And so Hitler was that way. He was easily manipulated by others, and he loved to hear himself, you know, give these mass orations, and he loved the pomp and the power, you know. And so he was convinced, okay, I'll tell the generals this is what you have to do. No scruples, you know. It says otherwise people won't love me. I like all these people coming hear me speak, you know. And if I don't do this, I'll let them down, you know, he thought. So he himself had scruples and second thoughts, and was brooding a lot. All this brooding was mean somebody who's really having second thoughts, like, wow, do I really want to do this? Do I really want to do this? Whereas these other handlers, you can see they weren't brooding. They're saying, look, kill every, we know what we want to do. No scruples. Let's kill all the Jews. No scruples. Let's kill all the Russians. Let's just kill them all. And then everything will go great for us. Don't worry. We'll just, and Hitler was saying, wow, that I might go down in history as a really bad person. What if I don't win? Like this is, wow, I'd really want to do this. I really want to be responsible for this. I really want to give the orders. So I really want to. So he brooded and brooded and was very depressed. This is a sign of somebody who's in great conflict. He was in great conflict about it. But the other ones who, they look at them, they weren't in conflict about it. You could tell they were like, yeah, go do it, do it, do it, do it. Now this is the dream that I had. It's the same thing. There's this person who this man who was trying to, wipe me out, and I said no. And then he said, wow, okay. Well, we gotta come to some compromise then. And then this other handler of him was on his side. This handler was absolutely furious. Say, what are you doing? We gave you orders. This is your, you got to do what we told you to do. And they felt betrayed. So this is the situation in the United States right now, actually. These demagogues always, they're not as bad as we think they are. It's the handlers around them that are the real bad ones, actually. But these demagogues are narcissistic, and they love to they want to feel loved by everybody. Everybody like, and they love giving big speeches and big stadiums and auditorium, and thinking that, everybody loves me. I'm a great speaker. I'm really not that good at speaking either, was Hitler a great speaker? Nah, screaming. He's a great screamer. He's like a motivational speaker. The Germans, of course, having been through Bolshevism and collapse of their economy, all sorts of problems. They had really severe problems after World War I, and they wanted a motivational speaker. And Hitler was a very good motivational speaker, very good motivational speaker, to try to build their arrogance back up, because their arrogance had taken an extreme hit in World War I. Very bad hit. They said, what do we do? Yeah, we lost. It's terrible. It's all the fault of the Jews, or all the fault of somebody else. They blamed it on the Jews. They'd lost. They said they lost their arrogance. And just Hitler pumped their arrogance back up. He's like very arrogant. He says, yeah, don't worry. Let's get our arrogance back. And so the people love to hear that. He's a great motivational speaker. He says, you can, we weren't the bad ones. They were the bad ones. God is still with us. Don't worry. We will right the wrongs. And the people said, oh, wonderful. So he did that thing. He did that thing. But he didn't, I don't think he realized that the extent that he was going to, go forward, and how, to what extent he was going to be completely vicious. He did not fully see that those around him who didn't have the charisma, who couldn't pump up the people's arrogance, who could not, because they were these slimy characters, very slimy characters. Goebbels and Goering, and there's a whole bunch of them, actually, Hess, who eventually so couldn't take it anymore and defected. There's a whole bunch of very slimy characters who had no scruples and had no charisma either, not an ounce of charisma. They couldn't do that, so they needed this guy. They needed this guy who'd pump up the arrogance of the people, so that then they could all have this, war machine again, and then try to perfect arrogance. So the demagogues, you find out throughout history, you find that they get the praise and the blame. They get the praise and the blame, but it's not quite that simple, cut and dried. It's oftentimes the hidden cabal behind them. That's where the real sleazy arrogance is, the terrible stuff where they think, hey, let's just wipe out our enemies. Let's project on project and destroy, project and destroy, project and destroy. project all your own arrogance onto the Jews, for instance, World War II, and then destroy them all. And then no more arrogance. See? Easy. So these are people who refused the challenge of Jesus and severely refused. They said, no, 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 no. We have a better plan. Project and destroy. Project and destroy. So that's what I had in this dream, is that there's this a tremendous attempt to project right now, which we're experiencing in the United States of America. There's a tremendous agenda being driven from the top of project, 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 and destroy, project, destroy. And there's a lot of resistance to that still here. For me, I said, no. That's not the way. That's not the way. That's not the way. You cannot perfect arrogance, okay? So repent. Repent. Stop projecting and repent. Stop projecting and repent. So, and yet there are these very slimy operatives, which I say many of my wife say radical feminists are very slimy. And they have no scruples. Their advice from the get-go, radical feminism from the get-go, was project and destroy, project and destroy. I very easily saw that and recognized, oh my gosh, this is Nazism. It's just that Nazis are wearing skirts now, basically. It's still Nazism. Project and destroy, project and destroy. Have no scruples, project and destroy. And they're still... that's still, you know, going on. This is what arrogance does. It advises you to project and destroy. Project and destroy. Project. This is what arrogance, the advice of arrogance. And if you don't have, if you haven't got a little Jesus in your heart, you know, if you don't have a little bit of truth, willing to listen to truth a little bit, then you're going to be, you know, go along with this agenda and say, oh, wow, okay. But you're still going to feel like, wow, there's something wrong. And they'll say, well, it's project and destroy. It's, you know, scapegoat them. So right now it's the Christians who are the new Jews. They're being targeted as the scapegoats. Project and destroy. Project and destroy. They're projecting all blame on Christians, and they want to destroy them. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Now, Christians are far from perfect, and they understand that. And they're not saying they are perfect. You know, they're saying, "Wow, yeah, we have a hard road to travel here. We know that we're still sinners. We know that we still have the sin of arrogance, and it's tough to set it down. But we're trying. We're trying our best, and we got to try better. And every day we get up and say, 'I got to try better. I got to ask Jesus, the Holy Spirit, hey, how can I do a better job of setting down my arrogance? Please help me.'" In a lot of ways, you could say World War II was just a trial run. You know, that they were projecting upon the Jews to try and, you know, cut the root of Judeo-Christianity off. So, but their real goal was to project upon Christians and destroy Christians. Project, and this is what Jesus tells us in the New Testament, is the end times. The whores of Babylon will be drunk on the blood of the saints, and the whores of Babylon are the radical feminists. And drunk on the blood of the saints, meaning they are trying to destroy Christianity. They really are. There's no two ways about it. We even have a political candidate right now in the United States who is saying, hey, we're right at the edge of saying that Christianity is nothing but a hate group. That's it. The whole catechism of the Catholic Church, of Christianity, is nothing but hate speech. It's nothing but a hate group. And we are right on that doorstep, as a matter of fact. This is true. This is very true. And we're more than on the doorstep. That program is going forward very severely. Very severely. And so, project and destroy is their marching orders. And the radical feminists, really radical feminazis, they're really Nazis. There's no way around it. When your ideology is project and destroy, you're a Nazi, plain and simple. You bear the stain of history upon you, because this has been done before in history many, 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 many times. Most recently the big example would be the Nazis. There's certainly others who've come up since then, but it's happening all over the world. But that's a very egregious example of it, that tried to completely wipe out the Jews. Their goal was to wipe off, kill every Jew on the planet. That was their goal. And they thought they'd found their scapegoat, and that just by projecting their own arrogance onto the Jews, they could destroy them. Now, the Jews made an easy target because the Jews tend to be pretty arrogant in their own right? Because of this ancient champion psych job of our champion is from God, your champion is from the devil, and therefore you can never win against us. They're still carrying the Old Testament law type of thing, of that psych job. They're still playing the psych job to a large extent. So they made a very convenient target for project and destroy. Project and destroy, very convenient target. But now Christians are the ones who are really being targeted. They're trying to psych out Christians now. They're trying to psych out Christians. Now, what I say to all Christians and everyone on the planet, Jesus is back. Jesus lives. He lives today. He's alive. And he's back here in this world. What I mean by that, in spirit, I don't know if he's back in body or not. I mean in spirit. He is back. And I'm aware that he's back. Is it the way he said it to me? Is my attention now is fully here? I have my full. You have my full attention. Okay. Now, where did he go? I don't know, but he was putting his attention on something else, something that was important, and he kind of had his attention, took his attention off of this, so that we could go through this process of consideration, and we wouldn't get caught up in worshiping or idolizing Jesus too much. He doesn't want us to do that. It's a very bad mistake to do that. He's not some champion that defeats our enemy, so to speak. He's a friend, a humble friend, who tells us that we're inherently perfect. We don't have an enemy to defeat. Okay, it's a different story. So he sort of withdrew from this world. He said, "It's better for you that I leave, and I'll put the Holy Spirit to help you." So he did kind of leave us, so to speak, for so we could sort this out. But he's back now. He's back because we're in this severe crisis right now. Christianity is being targeted. The work that he started is being targeted very severely, and their goal is to project and destroy, plain and simple. And you have people who have no who are doing this, burn and destroy, no scruples, because they don't have the honor of warriors. You don't have the warrior class is not running things right now. If it did, it would be a different story. It'd be a different story. Warriors have honor, and you know what? After the war, they can sit down with those that they fought against. You look at like the Vietnam veterans going back to Vietnam, and some of them are, not all of them, but some of them are being welcomed back by the very people, the warriors they fought against, and they say, "You know what? You're a really worthy opponent. We threw everything we could at you, and you're very tough. You're very tough." And they recognize the Viet Cong were very tough, tremendous warriors, and they respect that. They respect it, and so there's this mutual respect. Said, "Hey, we our government told us to go fight this war and win, and your government told you to fight and win, and we understand that. And you were a very worthy opponent. You were very tough and fearless, and we respect that. And now we're not fighting. Our country's not at war. Let's sit down and have a beer. And I'll meet your family, you meet mine, and let's be friends." This is how warrior, this is the warrior class. This is how they are. Warrior class is not a bad class of people. There's honor and respect, and they can set it down. They can set down the past. They can set it down. It's the ideologues that are the troublemakers in the world. It's the ideologues that are the troublemakers. They're those who for various reasons, feel that they need to project and destroy anyone to perfect arrogance. Those are the ideologues. And when ideologues get in control of a country, you're in big trouble. The country's in big trouble. boost in the light here a little bit, if I can. So there's tons of people who are speaking up about this in their own way, right? And I'm certainly not saying the catechism of Catholicism is blameless or completely right or anything like that. I'm very familiar with it. It's still very heavily sunk into compromise and Old Testament beliefs and compromise and stuff, and it's trying to keep putting new wine into old wineskin, and that's very problematical. But they're trying to take up the challenge, and so are Protestants, so is all of Christianity. They're trying. Of all races, you know, of all races, I've heard wonderful Christians who forgive others, forgive them. You know, I forgive you, and you know, this is, let us work on forgiveness and repentance, and I'm not blameless myself, so let me work on healing my relationship with God by setting down my own arrogance here. You know, all races, all people, both genders, ages, etc., all around the world, those who have taken up the challenge, you know, they're to be respected and promoted as good examples for everyone else. And the ideologues who believe in perfecting arrogance, they are not good examples for anyone, including themselves. Including themselves. They're not doing themselves any favor at all. None whatsoever. Do you think the Nazis' leadership was doing themselves any favor? No, they were not. They're not doing themselves any favor whatsoever. So what did the Germans who said, hey, you know, this is, there's no honor in this leader. This leader's crazy. Well, they tried to, you know, assassinate, what they tried to do, but they also fled. They tried to leave the country. And some other countries took them in and said, wow, these people are terrible. You know, we're not going to go along with this. No way. So what do we do? How do we flee this world? You know, how do we flee this world? Because this is a worldwide problem right now. You know, there is this, Third World War is already underway. It's been underway for quite some time, actually. The ideological underpinnings of it are being put in place. You don't have a war until there's an ideology in place behind it, and you have to have the majority of the people believing they're doing God's work by perfecting arrogance and, you know, project and destroy. You have to have them following a charismatic leader. You have to have them pumped up in it with arrogance that they have the way to victory. They know the way to victory now. There's all these ideological underpinnings. You have to first get the legal system on your side, which of course Hitler did. He basically suspended the legal system, suspended Parliament. I mean, suspended that. He said, I'm calling this an emergency mode where I don't have to go through you. I can just issue executive decrees. So he started just issuing all these executive decrees. Went around the legal system. Went around the political system. So you need to be able to do that. Need to be able to just make decrees. And once all these underpinnings get put in place, then you can start the program of severe projection. I mean, there was a purge, Hitler did this purge, the Night of the Long Knives, of a purging a lot of people in leaderships because they didn't feel you could trust them absolutely to have no scruples. So he got rid of them all. His own party, his own people. Purged his own people from his own party. And then the severe projection on the Jews began. You know, what they did is they first started tweaking the laws a lot. Some of the Jews said, hey, wait a minute, this doesn't look good. We've been through this before. And others said, no, don't worry. The law will protect us. Well, it didn't. It didn't. And we're in the United States saying, oh, don't worry. The laws will protect us. No problem. Well, history is not really on our side very much. Once you see all this stuff happening, is history is not really on your side. Once you get the demagogues and the controllers without any scruples, tweaking the laws, starting to identify what the scapegoats are, starting to make sure that the laws more and more identify how wicked the scapegoats are, you know, then you can turn the population, once the population is on your side, then you can start saying, hey, those people, that's where the hate's coming from. Let's destroy them. And then when you destroy that, that's where the arrogance is coming from. This is where our unhappiness is coming from. This is where the imperfection is coming from. Destroy them, and we'll have a golden age. This is exactly what the Nazis thought, that they'd have this Third Reich, which was their belief was in this golden millennial age, where all deformity and sickness and all the bad things that, you know, would be all gone, you know, it was all gone. And we'd have this golden age, ruled over by this master race of beautiful, genetically beautiful people who are, you know, superior, and they'd help the whole world through eugenics and genetic improvement, etc., to, you know, have this golden age of 1,000 years. This is their belief. Well, we still have that belief. We're just pursuing it right now by targeting Christians, actually. And they believe now that the way to have this golden age is to, you know, scapegoat and annihilate all Christians. This is ultimately their goal. And they're much closer to it than we realize. Just like the Jews said, well, you know, maybe, yeah, there's trouble. Yeah, we're being targeted and scapegoated, but we're a long ways away from any of the trouble. And some Jews said, you know, said, hey, no. Keep in mind history. You know, it happens fast. Once certain things get in place, the handlers of the demagogue put the pressure on the demagogue saying, you got to now act. You know, because the demagogue said, no, I just want to go play golf. You know, what do you mean I got to act? They said, no. You know, if you want to fulfill your destiny as the Messiah of this new world order, you've got to act now. And then the demagogue will give a speech and use all his demagogic power. Say, people of the nation, you know, I have now determined that we can no longer tolerate hate speech in our country. We can no longer tolerate the hateful ways of these people. And these people are holding back the golden age, the age of tolerance and peace and joy and love that you want so much and you so deserve. And we have the capacity now to lead you in this golden age. And we now can no longer tolerate the presence of these people in our midst. And they must be re-educated. They must change their ways, you know. And we're going to put them on cattle cars, and we're going to bring them to these re-education centers. We've set up these re-education centers. They told the Jews, look, we're going to, you know, re-educate you. We're going to take you to these nice places, and we're going to help you, you know, see the evil of your ways. They're going to re-educate you. And the people go, okay, yeah, that sounds good. Yeah, that these people are definitely the bad guys. They're the ones who are standing in the way of perfection here, perfecting our arrogance. So let's get rid of them. And who stands in the way more of perfecting arrogance than Christians in this world, actually? Because they're saying, no. Repent. You know, we're sinning. We're trying to sin against God. We're claiming that God isn't perfect. And so, you know, Christians are the ones who are standing in the way of this notion of we can perfect arrogance. They say Jesus died for your sins, saying Jesus was so certain that we had the sin of arrogance that he was willing to die, sacrifice his body to convince us. That's what we asked him to, convince us that what you're saying is true, that you're not trying just a liar. And he said, okay. And so when people say, well, Jesus died for our sins, he's saying, look, he died to convict us of our sins, to convict us that we do have the sin of arrogance. So we're not going to, Christians are not going to, they don't want to reject this, you know, reject Jesus. They said, wow, no, I mean, that's not the way. I mean, there have been how many millions of Christian martyrs throughout history? Huge amount. Books have been written about it, cataloging all the Christian martyrs throughout history. It's more than all the casualties of war throughout history almost. I mean, it's just an enormous amount of Christians have died for their faith. So arrogance has been targeting, you know, repentance for a long time in this world. And they're still at it. But they just plan on being much more thorough this time. And of course, Christians are saying, "Well, wow, what the heck are we going? What can we do about this? What can we do about this?" Yeah, absolutely. That's a question in our minds, and in the minds of everybody who's taken up this challenge to drop their arrogance. And that's everybody on this planet. Anyone who thinks their body in a world is running on sheer arrogance. Doesn't matter what you call yourself, what your race is, what your religion is, whatever. Anyone who thinks that they're a body in the slightest bit, that they're slightest bit vulnerable, believes in sheer arrogance, is running on the belief system of sheer arrogance. We're not a body at all. God did not create us as a body. God created us as spirit and truth. And we're still exactly the same as God created us. That's why we say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. That is a confession of a Christian. That's a confession of a repentant, someone who's taken up the challenge, who's willing to say that. Say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So the repentant ones can be very good at speaking too, but it's a different type of rhetoric, isn't it, that you hear? It's the rhetoric of repentance, not the rhetoric of arrogance. Hitler is very good at being arrogant. There have been other demagogues who are very good at pumping up arrogance in people. But that doesn't mean that no Christian can be a good speaker. Absolutely they can. But their speech is repentance, as meek, as humble, as repentant, as saying, hey, you know, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I can never be a body. I can never be in time and space and process and form. It's impossible for me. I can never accomplish the impossible. This is the fundamental confession of faith. Faith is I can never accomplish the impossible, and nobody can. No one can. And that's what the arrogant ones hate. When you say nobody can, that they can't stand to hear that. Because their whole belief in salvation is based on the belief that they can perfect arrogance. That's it. So when you say nobody can, you know, they say, whoa, 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 whoa. What they'll say is compromise here. Wait a minute, compromise. Wait a minute. They say, okay, we'll accept it that you can't do it if you accept that we can do it. You know, this is what they ask you for. And this is the compromise that we think, oh, well, we can have peace in the world. Okay, Christians can say that they can't perfect arrogance as long as the Christians accept that we can. And this is what the demagogues try to convince you. Because look, I'll convince them. The radicals, the handlers say, well, okay, we'll give you a chance to do that. We don't think that they're going to go for it. And if you fail at that, then you've got to go with our plan of severity. You know, that's how it is. So the demagogue thinks, oh, I can be the Messiah of the new era, but I don't have to be so severe. I can find my rhetoric. I can convince people of this. This is what Hitler is about. This is what other demagogues are about. But you can't convince Christians of this because it's not true. You can't convince anyone really, because there's no exception. Jesus tells us there's no exception. Nobody. No spirit is capable of perfecting arrogance, of making lies true. It's impossible. No one can ever do it. It will never be done. So once they realize that there are those who won't accept a compromise, then they say, wow, okay, I made this promise with my handlers that they would put me in position of being the leader. And if I failed at convincing people, then I have to go off their agenda. And now it's time to get severe and crack the whip. This is what happens. This is what happens. And history has shown us this. That first the demagogues rise to power. They're very charismatic. They seem to be fair-minded. And they promote something. And then it doesn't work. And then they say, wow, okay. And then suddenly they become very vicious. This is the lessons of history. And this is the situation we have right now. Particularly in the United States of America, actually. Very much in particular here. And so don't count on it that it won't become very severe, okay? Because there's been this fundamental failure to convince the Christians to go along entirely with their agenda. They might be saying, well, I'll agree to it so I don't lose my job, right? So I don't be completely ostracized. But deep within, they're saying, hey, you know, you're asking me to reject Jesus? I don't think so. Jesus proved to us, convinced us that we really are sinners, and nobody can perfect arrogance. It's impossible. I have the sin of arrogance, and this will never work. And Jesus, you know, so they're not, and so the handlers now are saying, hey, you lost. Okay, you made a deal. You make a deal with the devil, and the devil says, okay, you know, you now have to keep your part of the deal, which is now take a stand for severity. That's what they're going to ask for. Take a stand for severity. And they're getting it. You know, they're aligning all these different countries now with this general overall consensus saying, look, you've got the world behind you. Stand up and give a great speech or series of speeches saying we will no longer tolerate, you know, discrimination. We will no longer tolerate bigotry. We will no longer tolerate any hateful attitudes, you know, etc. But they're really saying we will no longer tolerate anyone who claims that this world is just arrogance, claims that Jesus was right. We'll no longer tolerate anyone who claims that we can't have a compromise here, that some are incapable, but some are capable of perfecting arrogance. We will no longer tolerate that. We will now, anyone who says that we cannot perfect arrogance, you know, goodbye. Goodbye. So we're at this time now. Now it's very interesting that Jesus has come back to this world right now. I say right towards the beginning of May, he returned his attention to this world and let me know about it. And not just me, he proclaimed it to the whole world. I just happened to have the ears to hear it. So I'm not claiming any, I'm no specialness at all. But I just done enough work to be able to put my attention and hear it and say, wow. You know, well, this is a big wow. Because most people are saying, oh, not yet, not yet. Because they're hoping that the severity won't come. They'll say, no, later. Like the Jews are saying, oh, I hope. No, the Nazis, and, you know, not yet, not yet, not yet. We can still stay here and we don't have to flee. So you always say, not yet. But I heard Jesus and I said, oh, wow, it's now. You know, it's on. It's on. So what do we do now? I don't know. But the fact that Jesus is back right now to me signifies that the severity, we're going to flip into the cycle of severity now, where the demagogues are going to be giving their speeches now, starting to specifically target a particular scapegoat, project and destroy, and they're going to flip into that phase of project and destroy, and so Jesus is back right at this time, realizing this is a whole global problem here. This is what he told us to look out for. To look for his return in these times that we're in. And he has returned. We are in those times. And we're likely now very close to project and destroy mentality now. It means the handlers will have, the demagogues in the world will realize that their plan of leniency, of trying to work a compromise. Demagogues usually, you know, that's what they want. I can convince people to compromise. I have the charisma to do that. But there's no amount of charisma in the world that can override the truth of that Jesus told us, okay? Can't do it. Those who have accepted the challenge of Jesus realize Jesus told us the truth. Jesus told us the truth about our situation. There's no exception to truth whatsoever. None. No one. There is no way ever to perfect arrogance. Arrogance is wrong. It's a mistake. God is perfect. We are perfect. And we'll always be so. So, Jesus is right. So, the demagogues, again, their way, they make a deal with the devil. They say, the handlers say, look, we think that you deserve to be this great demagogue, and we're going to put you in power, and we just want you to, you know, carry out an agenda. And the demagogue says, whoa, wait a minute. You don't need to be that severe. I think I can help the people by convincing them to go along with this compromise plan. And the handlers say, okay, they say, okay, look, let's make a deal. We'll make a deal. We'll give you X number of years to try and convince the people for compromise. If you fail in that time frame, then you will agree to do it our way. This is called making a deal with the devil. And there are certain people, demagogues, who have a lot of charisma and self-aggrandizement, who decide to make that deal with the devil. So they're put in power. The path to power is made easy for them. And you see somebody come out of nowhere who has no background. You say, wow, in the world, this person managed to get so much power. Because they made a deal with the devil, essentially. They have these handlers on their side who know how to intimidate people and get people into power. So when the time frame is up of their deal, then the handlers say, okay, now you're going to have to do it our way. And then the demagogue turns vicious then. See, Hitler was not vicious to start with. The people loved Hitler. They were absolutely adored him. Not only that, but many people around the world did. Many people. What was it? The foreign minister of of England, or who's that guy who went over there and said, "This guy's wonderful. We can trust him." Was it Chamberlain or somebody? I don't know. But they said, "We can trust this guy." And a lot of the country said, "Wow, Hitler's great. He's really restored German pride, German confidence, and he's a very nice guy," because he was preaching compromise. He preached compromise to Stalin. He preached compromise to everybody. But what happened was, the handler said, "Hey, you didn't do what we told you to do, actually. And so now you got to do it our way." And this is what happened. So then he started becoming this madman, complete maniac of giving these orders. Yeah, he was willing to do that. I'm sure that ideology, that spirit is right now saying, "What an idiot. What an idiot. Why did I do that? Why did I do that? Why did I use my talents in that way? Why did I use my skills in that way? Why did I use my confidence? Why did I do that?" And you have to then recognize, why, how it works, and repent and repent and repent, and accept that arrogance can never be perfected, no matter how vicious you get. So, it seems to be that the cycle of severity is ready to hit us here. When you have candidates for the President of the United States speaking out directly on this, who are saying we're right on the doorstep of Christians being targeted as a hate group, and we must not let this happen, that we're on the doorstep of disaster in this country. When you have like a major candidate for president saying that, you had better believe that we're at the doorstep of the situation, This is, we're in a drastic situation right now in this world, in the United States in particular. United States is kind of like Nazi Germany was before the severity suddenly started, actually, and a very powerful country, just like Germany was very powerful. Very disciplined, very determined. United States is very powerful, very di very determined, very disciplined, and right at the doorstep now of severity. Good news is Jesus is back. What he's going to do, I don't know. Yeah, I have not heard from him about that. But he is back. He is back, which means whatever is going to happen is going to happen, and he's going to do something. But we better be clear of the clear and present danger that is we're faced with. Like the Jews in Germany, the smart Jews said, "Hey, there's a clear and present danger here. Let's get out of here." That's the wise move. Some rabbis said no, some said yes. There's some Christians are saying, no, we can still work a deal. We can still work this out. We can find a compromise." And other Christians are saying, "Hey, they're not going to compromise. They mean to wipe us out." And indeed they do. And indeed they do. Now, I believe Pope Francis is a demagogue who's trying to construct some compromise. I really do. He seems to be a very good person, but he's trying to figure out a compromise between, those who are trying to perfect arrogance and the church. He's saying, "How can we keep the church going unless we work some compromise here?" And he's trying to do that. And so not everything he says is bad. I mean, he said some things recently are pretty good. Overall, he's trying to tell Christians, "Hey, don't worry. I'm such a great pope. I'm such a great person. I can work with these severe Nazis, and we can work out a compromise with them." He doesn't realize that he cannot. He doesn't understand. He's still believing in his own power and charisma. "I'm such a wonderful liberal pope. I can talk to these people." It's not true. He doesn't understand. That's like the Jews in Germany thinking, "Hey, we can talk with Hitler. We can, or the our English saying, "We can talk with this guy. He's a nice guy. We can work." They don't understand the viciousness behind it. okay, with the ideology behind it. So, you know, I don't put any faith in the Pope at all. He himself is a type of spiritual demagogue. I put my faith in Jesus. Let's see what Jesus is going to do. And I don't trust this Pope at all, as far as relaying the accuracy of what Jesus tells us right now. He believes that in his own power of education and liberal education of, sure, I can talk with these liberals, I can talk with these people, I can talk with these progressives, I can, we can, you know, we're both academic, we can come to an agreement. He doesn't understand who he's dealing with. He really doesn't understand radical feminism, etc. He doesn't get it. You cannot talk with those people. You cannot. They believe that their way is right and it's the only way, and your way is completely wrong and mistaken and needs to be annihilated. They believe in the power of projection from the very beginning. So you so he's just the Pope is just, you know, giving us false assurances, in my opinion. You know, for instance, Catholic country Ireland just, you know, decided to legalize gay marriage, and the Pope said this is a terrible defeat for humanity, a dark day. You know, he says it's awful, just a huge defeat for humanity. You know, because, you know, what more Catholic country in the world has there been other than Ireland? You know, and for Ireland to go against the teachings of the Catholic Church like this is just an extraordinary victory for the activists. Okay, and the Pope realized it was a devastating defeat. For Catholicism, devastating defeat. But doesn't he see the writing on the wall? Doesn't he see the writing on the wall? What's the bigger agenda, you know? So anyway, Jesus is back. Jesus is back, and he will do what he came to do. Plain and simple. There's no compromise in Jesus at all. Jesus knows that truth is true and no lies are ever true. There's no exception to truth whatsoever. None. You can take that to the bank, that this is it, the mind of Jesus knows. There's no exception to truth. What he's really saying is there's no exception to perfection. We're all perfect. There's no way we can be imperfect. It's impossible. We can never, never deviate one iota from how God created us. That's the mind of Jesus. So he's going to act in accordance with this truth, as well as being very pragmatic. And we're going to find out pretty soon what Jesus is going to do. We're going to find out very soon. And this May has just been a time to, you know, really purge us and clarify our minds of what's going on in this world, and get ready. You know, get ready for recognizing that when these severe ideologues, you know, when the leader who's made a deal with the devil, his time runs out. You know, it's hammer time. And they then drop all scruples. They think that's the way to win. Project and destroy is their ideology. The ones that are calling the shots in this world, project and destroy is their ideology, and they feel they have to win or they're going to be annihilated. So they're not in any mood to talk because they haven't repented. You cannot talk with an unrepentant spirit. They feel you're trying to trick them. And we already know that Jesus proved he wasn't trying to trick us. Okay, we said we demanded proof in the form of his death. He gave it to us. He said, okay, you want the proof? I'll give it to you. All right, so don't drop your faith, you know, now just because you hear somebody like myself talking about how you have to increase, you know, continue your repentance, continue your repentance. Don't be so provincial. That's no reason to drop your faith. I'm not anti-faith at all, 100% for it. But a lot of Christians have still a long ways to go. Still, they're still very Old Testament law kind of thing. They have to see forgiveness, the true forgiveness, the true inherent perfection. So they got a ways to go, but you have to keep going. You have to keep going. And so if you want to accept, you know, that Jesus, the covenant showing you that he was telling us the truth, and that his crucifixion convinces you of that, fine, fine, good, good, good. You know, I'm not saying drop that. I'm not saying drop that. Ultimately, you'll realize that you don't need that sort of demonstration, that you need to approach it through, you know, direct hearing of the truth, of reason, actually. You have to become very reasonable and clear in your mind and drop your confusion. But back then they were so confused, they said, well, I can't really figure it out in my mind. Just show me something very dramatic, some proof. And if we crucify you, you know, then that's the proof. And then resurrection proves that, you know, that he was really telling us the truth. He's not the body. We're not the body. We are not the body. We are not the body. So keep your faith. Keep your faith in Jesus. Keep your faith in whatever your tradition is that calls you to repentance, that calls you to drop arrogance. Okay? Not everybody has demanded that sort of proof of their teachers throughout history. But if that's what you that's what you wanted, that's great. Jesus gave it to you. Gave you the proof. So you're going to find out soon, you know, what happens to those. How's Jesus, what is Jesus going to do with his flock? Those who took up the challenge. What is he going to do with the flock right now? Because the flock is most certainly endangered here. Being targeted. Most certainly being targeted. Of course, they say, what do you talk about? There's a war against Christianity. We're talking, that's absolute nonsense. What are they? Well, what are they doing? They're projecting. They're trying to tell us that there's no such war when we see the targeting taking place constantly. They said the same thing to the Jews in Germany. We're not targeting you. What are you talking about? You're crazy. No, no, you're ridiculous. You're projecting. You're projecting. You know, they think that we're projecting. You know, when, you know, they're like they're ferociously targeting Christians, and they claim we're not targeting them at all. You're crazy. We're working this really wonderful compromise here, and you're the ones who are projecting. You know, that's their, you know, religion of projection. They'll never claim they're targeting. Even when the Germans, they killed so many Jews, they tried to exterminate them, they still claim they didn't do it. You know, they said, what are you talking about? Well, some of them, I mean, back then, they said, no. That's how strong projection is. They just say, no, we didn't do that. They're just making it up. It didn't, never happened. So this is what you get. Don't expect any sort of sanity from these people at all. Do not expect any sanity from at this point. I know it's kind of frightening to realize that your fellow spirits are temporarily unavailable for relating with you in sanity, but this is the case. This is the case. Temporarily. It's temporary, of course. They have no choice but to repent at some point, and they will. And they will. Absolutely have no choice. Even Hitler has to repent. Repent. And he will. Absolutely will. And it would be welcome back. Welcome back. Realizing, hey, I was created perfect. I can't change. That's impossible. I'm perfect. God say, absolutely. You're perfect, perfectly free. Your freedom has never been curtailed in any way whatsoever. Never will be. Everyone has to repent eventually. So temporarily, there may be quite a bit of the world that is temporarily unavailable to relating and sanity and truth to with, you know, with us. So, you know, that's unfortunate. It's unfortunate. But it's something we have to accept. We have to accept this now. This is, you know, this is the way it is right now. And honor their own creativity of thinking that they can perfect arrogance. It's just they're trying to honor their own creativity, thinking that, sure, we can do that. We can do anything. We can perfect arrogance. But what they don't understand is they're trying to perfect the belief in imperfection. They're trying to perfect the belief of imperfection so that it becomes true. They're trying to make lies true. This is what is going on here. Trying to perfect arrogance means trying to perfect that imperfection. Trying to perfect imperfection means that imperfection is the new perfection. Okay, this is their goal, that imperfection is the new perfection. It's not. Perfection is the one and only perfection. There's only one perfection. Okay, when people say there's only one Savior, it means there's only one perfection, not two. So the perfection of imperfection is not perfection. You cannot make it perfection. You cannot make imperfection perfection. Perfection is the one perfection. That's it. You cannot make lies true. You cannot say, well, I perfected lies and now they're the new truth. Because the old truth is still true. It hasn't gone anywhere. It hasn't gone anywhere. It never will. So do not be surprised in June, as we're going into June now, do not be surprised now if Jesus starts rolling out his grace upon the world, upon us. Do not be surprised at that at all. And we're getting close to June. What is today? Let me take a look at this. 30 days have September, April, June, and November. So May has 31 days. Today's the 27th, 28th, 29th, 30, 31. 4 more days, and then we hit June. And like I said, once we hit June, we have about a year. I feel we have about a year until the severity really becomes atrocious here. About a year. It's all it, but you know, it's like, you know, it's the Jews. For instance, the Jews had a certain amount of time before the cattle cars started rolling, before they couldn't get out of Germany. You know, that's the only way they could get out of Germany is on a cattle car. That's not the kind of way you wanted to get out of Germany, was it? Not at all. So we have about a year. We have about a year. Plus or minus a little bit, you know, about a year to, and we'll see what Jesus does in this next year. We'll see how it goes in this next year. This is what we're going to find out. We will find out this next year what kind of rollout does the grace of God have for us during these times. These are certainly the end times that we've been warned about. So what kind of rollout does the grace of God have for us? And we're going to find out very soon. So stay tuned and keep your faith. Keep your faith. Absolutely keep your faith and stay repentant and keep working on your arrogance and your own projections and keep trying to see the big picture. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me.